On episode 33 of The Monk Says, we're back. I've had a couple of weeks off, but I'm back. So tonight we've got a chat with my good friend, Mr. Gary Amor. He'll be on very shortly. And yes, we will be on the go. So we see. Who do you say? Let's get some sharing done. Sharing is caring. People might come and listen. People might not, but we're doing it. Doing it. Right, till he's on here, I'm going to put a bit of music. There we go. Enjoy.
Your signal in the distance to remain concerned. I think I lost my way. Getting good at starting
over. Gaz is in your own studio. Brilliant.
Thank you.
Brilliant. Bit of Foo Fighters there. Just waiting for Mr. Gary to come in. And we'll be on the go. Hope everyone's all right. We'll be talking about all sorts tonight. Mainly mental health. Because on your everyday window licker. So that's a big part of my life, and it's something I live with every day. Can you hear me? No, I can't hear you. I can't hear you, Gaz. It just doesn't even say you're online, my big man. Can't hear you yet. Try calling in, man. I'll send you an invite. Yeah, here we go. He's in. He's in. Hello.
I thought that link just sort of added me. I didn't realise I'd have to call in still. So my apologies.
Don't worry about it, mate. Don't worry about it at all.
I live life by three rules, mate. Never cheat on your wife, never steal from your friends, and never interrupt Dave Grohl when he's in full flow.
No, that's it. I thought a bit of Foo Fighters will light in the moon. And I like that's my favourite ever song. So,
is that your favourite ever, is it?
Well, one of my favourites, yeah.
I have to say, so the first Foo Fighters, because I was late to the party with Foo Fighters. I loved Nirvana when they were about, but I was late to the party with Foo Fighters, really. That late, that I think the first song I came across that really sort of introduced me to them was Monkey Wrench.
Oh.
Which is a solid favourite of mine. And embarrassingly, it was because I played one of the Guitar Hero series with Darren on I think it must have been a PlayStation 3, I hope. Could have even been a PlayStation 2, who knows. But there you go, yeah. And I went to see him at Milton Keynes Bowl about, blimey, 2000 and, what are we now, 2020, so it must have been 7 years ago then. Probably would have been after the Olympics, I would have thought.
Well before he busted his leg on stage then.
Yeah, long, long before that. Poor but yeah, I saw Biffy Clyro that night as well, and they were awesome. Biffy were brilliant. It was about the time their most famous album came out.
I always wanted to see Guns N' Roses live, but never got to.
Well, they were due a tour over here this year, weren't they? But that all sort of went by the wayside, so I'm not sure how good they'd be now.
You got a 3 hour spare just to wait for Axel to turn up. Turns up when he freaking likes, doesn't he?
True that, my brother, true that.
So how you been, Mr. Gary? Did you have a lovely birthday?
Yes, very good, thank you. On Friday, yeah, we had a few beers. You popped over and had a couple of beers with us, which I really appreciate, and I do thank you for that. It meant a lot.
Anytime.
And I appreciate that, man. And I mean, it was a reasonably quiet one, as you saw. There's, you know, obviously with everything going on at the minute, you can't have too many people in your house. And
no.
With the weather, we couldn't get out in the garden, so a couple of mates were going to come over. And I completely understand why they didn't come over, which was fine. And then what did we do Saturday? Not a lot in the morning because I was a bit of a thickhead, as you can imagine. But it was just a really good day. It was just, you know, I went up the castle in up Cold Ash Hill, which a place I know the landlords up there, Kirsty and Nathan, and they bought me a drink, which was nice of them. It's a wife's idea as well, not even my idea to go for a drink.
Oh, bloody hell.
Gotta love that, isn't you? So so it was really, really nice, and sort of spent the whole weekend sort of celebrating my birthday, I suppose, drinking, having a few beers and whatnot.
Yeah. Now you're self isolation because you got your big op on Thursday, isn't it?
Yeah, so it's not that big enough. I'm just having a bit of metal work taken out and the knee tidied up. But now I had my COVID test over at Basingstoke Hospital this morning. Ahead. I am negative, whichever means I haven't got it, that's what I am. And I have to say, What a service. I mean, you know, the NHS are sort of much maligned as either underfunded or overworked and everything else, but the job they do is fantastic. And you drive up to the testing centre in Basingstoke Hospital, you pull into effectively the tent that they've got set up. Someone comes out, you never get out of your car, they ask you who you are, you give them your name, date of birth and address. They whack a thing down the back of your throat, like a massive, great, long cotton bud, straight down the back of your throat, and you're sitting there going, trying your best not to spew up in the poor girl's face. And then she racks it so far up your uter, feels like she's scraping the underside of your eyeball.
Oh.
Yeah, it's not pleasant. And then they tell you you're done. And I think 6 hours it took to get my results.
Look at that. So
you cannot argue with that.
You shit on. Whatever test, you don't get no other. Normally, if you get a test come back that fast, it's bad fucking news, isn't it?
Ain't that the truth?
Jesus Christ. Well, fair play to him.
Yeah, so now I've got self-isolate. I'm not allowed to share a bed with a wife until I come home from hospital. I'm not allowed to. I'm not supposed to sit within a metre and a half, 2 metres of the family. And I'm certainly not supposed to merge with members of the general public. So I'm sat in my shed, keeping away from everyone. So,
and you're on the Matt the Monk podcast, which is just as good.
Why wouldn't I want to be when I was, if I've got to isolate, what better way to isolate is there?
Mm. Well, we're back. I took a couple of weeks off because I felt I needed to.
Absence makes the heart grow fonder, Matty. Yeah, you know, yeah, but when you don't do your show, you have more people listening.
Yeah, so this is episode 33, and I've done 39 hours worth, according to the old company. So I've done a fair few hours. So it's been
can't remember that.
Here we go. Look, Sky Sports News, breaking news. Lionel Messi has told Barcelona he wants to leave the club.
Do you know what? My boy's been telling me that for weeks, and I mean weeks. He's been saying Messi's going to leave. And I've been going, oh, I can't see it. Why would he want to leave? They win, you know, they're always competing for everything, but I suppose it's just popped up on my iPad as a thing. Yeah, he wants to leave the club. I think his contract's up this summer, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. So he's not signing a new one.
So
where do we think he'll go?
If he goes for free to somebody, oh my God.
So what about, because there's talk of Cristiano Ronaldo going to Paris Saint-Germain. So what if you end up with Ronaldo and Messi at Paris Saint-Germain? You've already got Mbappe there and you've got Neymar there. How does any club in the world deal with that for? And how do you play them?
And how the hell do they not win the Champions fucking League?
I have to say, because Bayern Munich were awesome. I mean, I watched it. My boy said, Ben, he said, come on, Dad, let's watch the Champions League final. So he told his mum to bugger off to bed, as she did what all good wives do, and left the boys to watch the football. She watched a bit of it, actually. She wasn't that impressed. But Ben said, oh, it's a bit of a boring final, only one goal. And I was, got to be honest, I was intrigued by it. I thought it was two teams playing some really good football, but not creating loads and loads of chances. Some good defending, some good attacking from both sides. And the German keeper, what's his name?
Neuer.
No, yeah, Manuel Neuer. What a save he made at the end with his foot. Come flying out of goal and made one hell of a save.
Isn't he the captain? Yeah, I think so.
Well, he's been, a lot of people have been saying he's on the wane over the last few years, and he's coming to the end, towards the business end of his career, being in his sort of, I think he's in his early 30s, but wow, the save he made.
Always goalkeepers get better with age, not worse.
Absolutely. I mean, there's a tipping point, isn't there? But it's usually sort of late 30s before they start to dip off. It's usually you tend to find that your goalkeepers, your defenders sort of start to get to their peaks, their peak at around sort of 26 to 30. Your midfielders are usually sort of 28 to 32, 34 at their peak years. Your strikers are tend to be a little bit younger, sort of, I don't know, 24 to sort of 29, 30. Yeah. But your goalkeepers, they don't hit their best form until they're in their 30s, I don't think. Look at the likes of Fabianski at West Ham. We've been absolutely dog shit for 2 years with him in the side, and he's been a difference between us staying up and going down. When we had Roberto in there earlier in the season, that's what ended up. He probably lost us 10 points. We'd have finished mid table if Fabianski was fit. And then you look around the leagues, and all of the players, all the goalkeepers in the top clubs are all either in their 30s or come into their 30s. So, even Alisson at Liverpool, he's sort of late 20s now. Yeah. I think he's about 28, isn't he? So that's something like 27, 28. De Gea's sort of late, coming into his late 20s. And they're just improving. They're just improving every year. I mean, I know De Gea's had a bit of a shaky year this year.
But he's still a quality keeper. My God.
Yeah, I mean, you think... I mean, as you well know, mate, I played in goal for all my adult life, and as a kid. And I didn't play to any real standard, decent standard. I played a couple of games in non-league football and what have you. But when I say non-league, I mean like the bottom of the non-league pyramid, just above park football. And that was only because I had to take my gloves on the day goalkeepers didn't turn up. But I think... as someone who's played in goal a lot over the years, when you, especially at a poorer level, you know what it feels like much more to when you make that mistake. It just always leads to a goal. Whereas a striker can miss an open goal and the team will still go on to win or get a draw, even if nothing else happens in the game. A defender, will have other defenders and the goalkeeper potentially to save him. Midfielders can lose the ball or mess up a cross or mess up a through ball, and it doesn't have particular bad bearing on the game necessarily, because they'll have chances after chance to redeem themselves. But if a goalkeeper makes a mistake and concedes a goal as a result, which usually will happen, that's it. There's no getting it back. You can't save a penalty and say, well, at least I saved the penalty, because you still let the goal in.
Yeah.
At least with a midfielder, if a winger messes up a cross, the next time he gets down the wing, he can whip a cross in for the striker to head in. And that messed up cross is then forgotten because he's still got a good one in for the striker to score with.
Yeah.
Defenders miss a tackle, a keeper comes out and makes a save. No one really talks about that unless, there's a good chance that the keeper is still going to help him out. But, as a goalkeeper, you're always punished for your mistakes. And I always, when I see goalkeepers getting criticised, it's like when boxers get criticised for their performance, I always think it's usually by the fat bloke that's never played a day sport in his life, sat in his sofa eating pizza. Yeah. Oh, if I'd have done that, of course you would, mate. You probably never played a game of football in your life.
But I hate it when people criticise, especially the boxer, in that. If you've got the guts to get in there, fine. You can criticise all you fucking like. But if you ain't, shut your fucking face until you're out.
Well, I think football's often an exception there because with football, most people who watch football would have played a bit of football, and these guys are paid exorbitant amounts of money just to kick a football around.
Yeah.
With most other sports, there's a level of skill involved that very few people have got, or there's a level of competitive edge that people have in that sport that very few people have. You don't get, most people who watch rugby don't criticise rugby players if they make a bad pass, because those boys have to put themselves through a lot in a game of rugby. But a game of football is just football, do you know what I mean? You get a kick, you don't hurt. I mean, a couple of times watching the Champions League final on Sunday, you had, I can't remember it, well, I think it might have been Neymar, got one of the Bayern players booked. I mean, you saw the replay, barely touched it, but the guy just rolled and rolled and rolled and screamed. And I just can't,
he'd have tackled him, I promise.
Yeah, probably. He'd still be rolling now if you'd have got hold of him. Oh, but, with boxing and rugby and sports like that, you should, there's no way you should criticise those people taking part, even if you have played. Yeah, and if you play that, if you partaken at the level that you know, if we look at the weekend when Dillian White got sparked by Povetkin, yeah, if you boxed at that level and there was and you thought,
what the hell is that? That's better.
Blimey.
Yeah, it went funny, yeah, but don't worry. Say again.
So if you've got, like, you know, if you box at the same level as Dillian White and you think he's done something wrong for him to get knocked out in that fight, which I don't happen to think he did, I just think he got flushed by a good shot, you've got every right to criticise him because you've done it at that level. Football's a little bit different because even though the guys that are playing it are phenomenally good at what they do and they've got an inherent level of skill, I just think it's a much simpler sport to partake in. So everybody can play it to a certain level. And it's easier to become, I guess it maybe it's just because it's a sport I understand and I've played so much over the years and albeit not to a shit standard, but I just feel I think more people are right to criticise football because we all understand more about the sport than sports like boxing and rugby and I think cricket as well to a degree, even if you've ever played cricket, you haven't had someone chuck a cricket ball down at you at 80 mile an hour.
No, but I hate cricket. That's because I was forced to play as a kid at school and I hated it.
I thought we were changing tactics and I thought we were talking about someone.
That's true as well. That is very clever.
Well, but yeah, I mean, sorry, go on, man.
Yeah, well, he's out and about now. He did get he was incarcerated for a little while, but he's out and about again.
Oh, bless him.
So hopefully he just keeps his nose clean and just gets on with his fucking life.
Well, let's hope he can move on and settle down. But let's keep it.
Yeah,
let's keep on subject. Yeah.
Yeah, Mrs. B's she'd go into one.
let's not upset Mrs. B. We've heard all about her left hook.
Yeah.
So yeah. Talking of the boxing at the weekend, yeah, you were saying to me earlier you've watched a lot of it back now.
I have now. I didn't watch it live because I didn't want to pay £20 to watch a fight in the back garden. If I wanted to do that, I would walk around the estate and I was a foul one.
Yeah. Drag the first person you've seen off the street into your back garden.
Yeah,
yeah,
but
I have to say the whole fight camp series is, I've not watched them all. I think I've watched two of them, and this one was brilliant. I really enjoyed it. I just think it's a really good way to, you know. There's a lot of criticism for boxing these days, and for sportsmen that earn fortunes in this time, and you know, whenever there's real sort of financial strife going on, but actually to put something like that on, they can't have been paid fortunes because I mean that's why the last one was pay per view, I guess, was to try and drive a bit of money into it to get the big fight, but they wouldn't have been paid the monies that they would have been paid for previous fights. And this, I can't see it because I don't think Eddie's he's not that generous, is he? Let's face it. But that house, I mean, that's a hell of a house, isn't it?
That is beautiful.
Do you know, that's apparently their office.
That's their office, is it? Well, yeah, when white collar boxing gets that big, we want an office.
I've got my eye on the place, to be fair.
You know,
as you go through Speen, you get to the roundabout where the A34 junction is.
Yeah.
Just on the left, as you go straight over the A34, just on the left, there's like a little slipway that goes down to a gate. And behind there's a big old house that's been turned into offices. And if we ever get up to Eddie's level, maybe that'll be our Matching Square Gardens.
Well, that'll do.
Yeah.
And I'll be the old boy just whinges and I lock up at night. That'd be fine.
Yeah, you can be the old what they call gamekeeper. You can wander around the grounds, scaring off the little kids scrumping apples out of the
perfect. That'd be perfect. Matt would be more than happy to do that.
I know your dad. Outstanding.
I'm there in my taser. That'd be brilliant.
Yeah. Keep that bloody thing away from me. It scared the life out of me, that did.
I've hit it now.
We got somebody asking something, a guy called Caps.
Oh, yeah. What do you think?
What did you think about Pov versus Dill?
We've just been talking about that, Caps. It was very good. I was gutted for Dillian Wright. But is what he's going to get a rematch. So
November, apparently.
Yeah, we'll see if he can right or wrong. But if you can't, I don't know where he stands.
To be fair, I mean, that's the beauty of heavyweight boxing, what happened on Saturday. I think Dillian White went in with a completely different mindset to normal. He'd normally go in there and he'd go to war from the moment he got in the ring. But he looked like he wanted to box. He was boxing off his jab. He looked like he was moving well. He looked like he was dealing with everything Povetkin had to throw at him. Povetkin was doing what he normally does, which is looking to set up the big bombs, either the big right hand over or the left hook, and you know he got knocked down twice. And and I said at the time they were flash knockdowns. They didn't look to have him troubled. But what I did think was that's, you know, as we know with Povetkin, that's when he's at his most dangerous. That's when he's likely to fight back. I think he's. I think. What's he just written? Yeah, I think that's absolutely right. When White had Povetkin troubled, I think he could have gone to 10, but I think he was worried about exactly what happened. I think he was worried what was going to happened, and
yeah,
you know, it was a beautifully set up. It was a beauty. I mean, anyone that's been involved and trained with us and done any pads with us will know that the jab, slip, uppercut is one of the first pad combinations that we ever put on. Not because we think anybody's going to learn the front, but just because throwing a jab and slipping slipping outside a jab is just a sensible thing to do, and an easy punch to throw off it is an uppercut or a hook, and that sort of jab, slip, whack the uppercut in. Usually we make it as a bit of a body shot more than anything, because you know when the jab arm's fully extended, if you can slip it and stick a body shot in, that really hurts. But no, it nearly took his fucking head clean off, and his eyes were in the back of his head. He was rolling backwards.
Gone. You know it's bad because they put him straight in the recovery position.
I can't remember what I was watching, but I'm sure I watched. I'm sure it must have been something that's happened over lockdown, because it was a boxing match. It wasn't live, but it was a boxing match with no crowd, and the guy got knocked out, and you could hear, like, he was almost snoring. The guy that was knocked out was almost, I can't think who it was now, but he took a shot, went down and on the floor, and you could hear him going, like making a real sort of snoring noise. It was unbelievable, but
that's scary.
Yeah.
Bloody hell. Wow.
But I thought there was better fights on the night. I mean, the Katie Taylor fight. I had Katie Taylor winning that by two based on winning the last three rounds. I thought I had it even going into the last three rounds, give or take.
Right in her face.
But that Persoon, I mean, even she said she thought she'd lost at the end. She knew she'd lost at the end. And I think Katie Taylor showed how good a boxer she is. She's not got a lot of power by the looks of it. I mean, not that I'd want to get punched by her, but you, in the grand scheme of that level of boxing, you know, no. She doesn't look like she carries a lot of knockout power, but my God, she beat that woman senseless. I mean, and a lot of people were straight away were on her case saying, oh, she's you know, they've given it her again, and Persoon should be.
Oh, no,
I thought Persoon was very wild. A lot of the shots she threw missed or landed on Katie's gloves, and you know Katie was just firing shots off and landing them. And you know, I mean, I didn't see what the punches landed percentage was, but I thought it was probably as high as you'll find him in any big world title fight. She had that massive lump on her forehead as well. Did you see that, yeah. Katie Taylor? Jesus, she did take one decent shot at least.
Yeah, bloody that hematoma was, my God.
Yes, and the one on Pursue's cheek come up quick, didn't it?
Yeah. Thank God we haven't seen no injuries like that in any of our bloody things.
Ben Johnson. I'm going to say Ben Johnson. Ben that fought it might have been the Judgment Day show or the Evolution show.
Yeah,
the next day, he said he blew his nose. Ben Richards, that's it. Thank you.
Yeah, his eye pops, isn't it?
Yeah, he blew his nose next day and his eye popped. Hang on, what's he saying now? Because he's...
Ben Richards.
So, Katie surprised. She's lucky she has control. Last round didn't look good, to be honest. Now she won, but she didn't look as bad as the other. She won because of boxing movement, absolutely. But boxing movement, without a doubt. Yeah, absolutely. Their footwork was phenomenal. But I think my favourite two fights on the night were, well, actually, they're all decent fights, but I like the first one, the Chelly versus Cullen. I enjoyed the Luther Clay versus Congo one. Luther Clay from Bracknell, just up the road. That was a good fight. And that Alan the Savage Babbage is now one of my favourite boxers.
And what a great
name! What a great Alan the Savage Babbage. Yeah. He does not give a. He looked in both his pockets as he got out of the ring, and he did have no fucks left to give. He's the sort of guy that will get in and fight anyone. And who did I see? I think it was Rich Loveday was saying maybe he should take on Phil Williams next, the guy from the pro heavyweight from Swindon. I'd like to see that, because I'd like to go on, if it was low, especially if it was local on like the next Fight Town show or something like that, when boxing comes back live around here.
Oh,
I'd love to go and see Babbage live. I think he's all action, he's all good fun, and he looks like a Viking. He had a big bushy beard, didn't he? Did he have a bald head? I think he had a bald head, can't remember. Definitely had a big bushy beard, and he just looked like an animal.
Caps would like to call him. Hang on. Let's connect him up. Hello, my brother.
You're all right, bro. How you doing, man? Good.
No, not too bad. How you keeping?
Yeah, not bad, man. Not bad. Just working. I've done like a 14 and a half hour stint today. Fuck's sake, man. But anyway, yeah. So what do you reckon with this? I've seen it on a bit of Facebook and that. Like, fucking, they're talking about Anthony Joshua with the WBC and that.
I might have missed it. What's that all about?
Well, you know Tyson Fury, you know, like in next year, early next year or something like that.
What, trying to fuck Fury? Fury versus AJ?
What do you reckon?
Needs to happen at some point. I reckon,
Tyson Fury is that much of a wanker. Yeah, he'll end up doing AJ. But you know why I think that? Because of AJ's lack of it. Like, I still think AJ is lacking experience. I'm not gonna lie. Like, I like AJ. I've never not liked him, but I will be genuinely honest. And genuinely honest is realistic. And like the way he's been boxing lately, like he goes all or nothing, and if he just steps back, he had to step back with Ruiz, and he did, and he won. That's what he's meant to do. That's how you box. But like, if you don't, people say, "Oh, he was thrown away." No, he was boxing. That's how you box. Simple. Do you know what I mean? Like, anyone who tries to say, "Oh, he played a shit fight there," is no. You're a fucking idiot. You don't know how to box. So that's how you box. You play safe all the time to a degree, but. Like with a man of his power and their chin of his at the minute, and you know, at the end of the day, only my opinion, not everyone's, just mine. But like, I believe that, like, if they both played the same game, I think Tyson would win. But if he went in, if he went in on Tyson, I think AJ's got a complete and utter chance. Complete and utter chance. But it's if he goes in harder than Deontay, like, if you know what I mean, you know.
Yeah. I think it's one of those fights. For me, it's one of those fights that it's going to...
They're both good boxers. Two British problem.
Yeah, two British guys. I think it will split the country 50-50. I think those that think Fury will win will be adamant that he'll win. Those that think AJ will win will be adamant, and at the end will either be surprised or it'll be a draw, and it'll probably end up being three fights. And
I just believe, you know what it is with me. I believe that, like, you know, all right, Deontay Wilder and rare, but Deontay Wilder is a puncher, but he isn't a fighter. Like, I don't believe he's got technique. He's got technique, but not much. Where with Tyson Fury, his whole game is technique. His whole fucking game is technique. And that's why. And I'm not saying he ain't a puncher. Not at all. He is a puncher. He's a big boy, man. But the point is that, like, with AJ is a big boy. You know what I mean? And if AJ clever enough, he probably could take Fury out. But it's a fit, like you just said, purely, you're right, you cock on, 50-50. It is a pure 50-50, that is. I wouldn't even put 60-40 on it. I would be 50-50 with that. It is pure 50-50.
Yeah, I don't think I could call it. But what I would say with that, I think AJ pound for pound carries more power. So if they came
AJ
carries more power. But I think because of his size and because of the length of his levers, you know, you don't. If you're 6'9" and 18 stone, you hit hard. I don't care.
Of course you do. Of course you do.
Yeah, especially when you've got the skills and technique.
No, but you don't go too. You don't go too forward too quick. That's where you go wrong, because you anger and then you end up slugging it out. And so, you know, that's where the cleverness comes in. So if they play clever for the first couple of rounds, this is where AJ will lose. Do you know? Everyone, I believe that's the way it will go. Like, if AJ goes in on the first, look at his career. If he goes in on the first 0-5 rounds, he could possibly win. But if he plays this, the game of, like, the way Klitschko played it with Tyson Fury, like, the two tops, and you know, that's the danger. If he plays it to the fourth round and thinking that Fury's gonna gas, he ain't gonna gas. The only fucker who's gonna gas is gonna be fucking Joshua. But I'm not saying he still wouldn't win in the ninth, you know, because you get that second burst.
It'd just be awesome to see. We will see.
It will be brilliant. It'll be brilliant. No, that's why I'm talking about it, because I just think it's going to be a spectacular fight, that is, if it happens.
When was the last time we saw two British heavyweights fighting for a title? No, we have. Lewis and Bruno, I think.
Sorry. Yeah, but Lewis is Jamaican, isn't he?
Canadian.
Yeah,
he's
British.
He's a little bit of all, isn't he? But,
and we all.
That was
15, 20
years ago.
Yeah. That's a long time. I'm 34 now, so I remember that fight. I do remember it.
You're a mere youngster, my man. You're a mere
youngster. I know. And I love my boxing, so fuck off. Listen, I'm only joking.
I've always taken, don't worry. But Matty's called me a lot worse than that over the years.
That's brilliant.
But I think the beauty of boxing is it's one of life's great levelers. I mean, when you get into boxing, you always meet people, and like most sports, people have opinions. But generally speaking, the vast majority of people you meet, when they love boxing, they respect everybody's opinion. I mean, you go on some of these Facebook pages, and some people are just
they're just horrible, aren't they? You know, we're grown up.
That ain't the real world anymore, anyway, is it? But like, you know, most people, when you talk about boxing, everybody respects everybody's opinion. Obviously, people disagree, because that's the beauty of opinions, and that's what makes
Definitely. Look, if we didn't have the same, sorry to butt in, but if we didn't if we all had the same opinion, we'd be fucking robots, wouldn't we?
Well, there's a fair few of them about these days with what's going on in the world,
aren't
there?
Do you know what I mean? There is, I ain't a follower, I'm a leader, and look, if my decision's wrong, then I'll take it on the chin. I take it on the chin, just like everything, that's it. You take it on the chin, man. It's, you remember Frankie Gavin? You remember Frankie Gavin?
Yeah.
Yeah, I boxed with him a couple of times, man.
Nice.
Yeah, man.
That was an interesting experience.
It was beautiful, man. I trained in his gym for a bit and a couple of, about a year. And it's nice. I know a good couple of the lads. It's cool. But, it's just nice. It's nice to, small leaf, but it's nice to have that. I got kids now. I'm an engineer. I didn't go into anything, but I just trained, and I love the sport, I love it. I love it a bit.
You didn't fancy getting in and doing a white collar fight at any point?
I didn't do nothing. I'm not going to lie. I didn't do nothing, mate.
Well, you're not too old.
No, I sparred and that.
Come and do some white collar with us. Come on.
Mate, I can fight. I tell you, I'm a southpaw as well. I'm a southpaw.
Oh, no, I've got two of them on. Off the barrier.
I'm a left footer as well, man. Yeah. But I love my boxing, man. Seriously, I can. You can tell me. You could tell me, actually, to be fair. Where are you?
We're down near, we're both sort of either side of Reading. Matty's the same as me. No, we're the other side of Reading to London. I'm in Birmingham, obviously.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, we're down south. But, would you say you were 34? I've just turned 46. And,
go on, mate.
Four white collar fights, all of them after I was 40.
Go on, son. Oh, you're joking me.
No, I fought four times.
You know what? I'm sorry to call you son. That's cheeky, isn't it?
mate, you're 34. You keep calling me son. It makes me feel young.
All right, then.
I like you already. the beauty of white-collar boxing, I feel, is especially when it's done right, and, we like to think we do it right when we do it.
Yeah.
There's a lot of good shows, especially around your way. There's a lot of good shows up around your way. I think Triple G Promotions. I can't remember them all off the top of my head, but there's a few all round the sort of Birmingham Midlands area. I want to say ICB.
I got offered. That Ginge. You remember? Did you hear about that Ginge? That Ginge kid. I know him. I do. You remember? He was on YouTube everywhere. Fucking. The fat kid, the chubby kid, with ginger hair with one tooth missing and that. And he had some mad, Shard End he was from.
Yeah, I think I know you're talking about. He had one mental viral video, didn't he?
And that was it.
Jesus, you should have taken that.
I knew him when he was a little kid, man.
I have to say, my third white collar fight was against a guy I got on really, really well with, and I trained with for a couple of years.
Oh, wow.
And I got matched up with him because we trained at the same gym. It was our gym's, our coach's show, and we ended up matching up. I was sat in the venue at a bar, like a pub next to it, and my parents came to watch. The first time they came to watch me fight. And I introduced him to my parents before the fight, and we sat while they were having a beer, and we had a sort of bottle of water each, and we were chattering away with my mum and dad. And it was like, we're going to go in there and smash the fuck out of each other.
That's the horrible thing about it, isn't it?
Well, no, I kind of liked it, because we just, it was,
I don't like to be friendly, because look, I'm not going to lie, you know me, I don't fight properly if you've got to punch me in the fucking, if we're in a street, I'm older now, so it's different, but, back in my day, I'm not a horror, I've never been, I'm a keeper of peace if I can be, I'm the opposite, but I knew a lot of people who were horrible bastards, you walk down the road, and someone would go, yo, and I'd go, calm, man, just calm down, just leave it, and they'd be like, who the fuck are you little prick, and I'd be like, mate, don't, and they'd swing for me, and chip my chin, and I'd be like, sweet, brilliant, because I got heat, now I can just open up. and I just go under him, boom, boom, and then bang, he's gone out. That's it. And they're all like running over to him, and I'm like, no, don't stamp on him, don't stamp on him. Let him get up. Let him see if he wants it again. And then I'd let him get up, and he'd go, no, I'll go, sweet, see you later, mate. You know, shake my hand and go, thank you. You know, I'm not that, you know, we've got to be like that, because people who can move the hips and you can give the proper punch, it's a shame for people, man, because you can kill them, you know. I've watched two people in my life, man, go fucking jail for fucking 12 and a half years because of it. One punch and they're gone.
Yeah.
You know, my mate, his son went to a toilet in the pub, so he's had a piss in the toilet, his son has, and some geezers walked past him and like, done that to his hair. You can imagine what I'm doing, and he like, going to his hair. And went, what the fuck are you doing in here? And walked off from him, like, nothing wrong, but like being a bit, just why did you have to do that, you know? So his son's come out and said to his dad, who ain't no fool, and he's gone, oh, dad, did a little, and he went, who? And he went, boom, him. And he knows his son ain't lying, his son's too young to lie, if you know what I mean, he ain't gonna fucking bullshit. And and he just walked over, bang, cracked his head off the, you know, like outside the pub, you know, where, not outside the pub, you know, your bar, you know, the bar.
Yeah,
you know, you got a step, just like there was a step just in front of the bar, so he's dropped and landed on that step. His head has banged on. Yeah, fucking died, man, dead, man. Yeah,
it's not. You know what I mean? That's why. You know,
Matrix.
Just gotta keep it. Just gotta keep it in the ring, and you keep it in the ring.
Yeah, keep it in the ring. That's it.
Yeah, it's what I mean, because like, you know, you got to protect yourself, but it's dangerous, man. Like, people come to me, like, you know, you people underestimate you all the time, and it's dangerous. I don't like that.
Fighting's a last resort for anything. I always feel if I've been in a scrap, right, outside, which won't happen now, I'm 40, for fuck's sake. But if it, I felt like I'd lost.
Don't matter if you're, mate, 40, you're at your fucking prime, you cunt. I'm not being funny, but you know what I mean? You're not old.
You've not met Matt, have you?
No, but it doesn't matter. What do you, does he think I'm being horrible because I called him a cunt?
No, not at all, no. Matt is at his peak, really, but Matt was a very different person. When I first met him,
he was a wanker. 15 years.
No, not at all. But he wouldn't be looking to keep the peace. Not in his past. Matt would be one that.
And I hope
you don't mind me saying this, Matty, but I think if somebody upset Matt 10 or 15 years ago, it would have been a very different outcome to now.
Now, see, this is the thing. Yeah, see, you sound like my brother. Now, if you sound like my brother, what I'm going to say is, like, my brother was either going to be dead or locked up. Simple. Yeah? And what happens is you either change or you're going to be dead or locked up. And that's what you did. Simple as that, mate. It is as simple as that. Because I watched it. I watched people get stabbed in the throat. And I ain't saying it for fucking fun. I ain't lying to you. I lived in Alum Rock for fucking 12 years. Do you know where Alum Rock is?
No. The name rings a bell, but
Ward End. No, I'm not trying to throw areas at you, but what I'm saying is, like, bullshit areas where you gotta keep on your toes, you've gotta open your eyes, and the best thing you could do is get into boxing. Do you know what I mean? So
I think a lot of the societal problems now that we've
got nothing to do.
Yeah, it is. Because I've got a problem with one of my eyes, so I wouldn't have been allowed to box as an amateur or a professional. Not that I was ever any good enough to compete at a decent level of those. But when white collar
came... It's not even about that. It's not about if you're at a decent level. Sorry, but it's not about a decent level. It's whether you try or not. You can get better. Everyone's learning. I'm an engineer for 18 years and I'm still learning.
Yeah, absolutely. I think nowadays the thing is, like, you need to keep these kids... that are about now you really need something for them to focus on, and it, you know, and it goes down to even things like, you know, the areas of London that have got the highest levels of crime, or whether it be Birmingham or Manchester. If you throw money at them for the kids to have positive, I mean, Matty and I talked on one of his previous podcasts about it, and it genuinely is as simple as, I think, if you give these kids positive parental role models, whether they be male or female, but mostly male, and positive positive things to do with their lives. They don't look to the drug dealers and the gangsters and the hard men and the wannabes to be the role model. Do you know what I mean? They look at the people that are the boxing coaches, the football coaches, the whatever it is. You know what I mean? The youth leaders. They look at them as, and if they're positive, if their behaviour is positive, they grow up with those positive traits.
You need that, man. It's like, listen, like, can you agree with me? I've got four children, man. I've got a 12-year-old, an 11-year-old, a 10-year-old, and a fucking 7-year-old, yeah. And if, you know, discipline, like, I got punched in the head when I was a kid, man. There weren't no fucking about with me. But it was a bit unnecessary, but, like, when I got out of my house, it was the way it was. But the point that I'm getting at is this. I don't treat my kids like that. I really don't, because I didn't, you know, I hate my dad now, and you know, and I'm not trying to go on like I love him, but I don't like him, if you know what I mean. I don't hate him, sorry, I chose the wrong word there. But what I'm trying to say is that if my dad got me into boxing, or I done it for myself, if you know, with my son, I've tried and he said no, I don't want to, but my other son, he does. Same. So like my two daughters, my one daughter does, so there's two that do. So I'm really looking now. I'm really looking. Now they're getting a bit bigger. And I train with them. I play with them. And I fight with them. And I tap them and they punch me hard. You know, and I let them, to a degree, you know. I say, calm down. You're busting my teeth out. You know?
I think there's a lack of there's a lack of opportunity for kids in most areas to get involved with something like boxing. We live in a reasonably nice town. There's not masses of crime, although it has its areas like anywhere else. But we've got one amateur boxing gym. Yeah. Why did you find so funny about that, Matt? It has got its areas, hasn't it?
Yeah, it has
like
got its areas, because
I'm sat in
one of them.
Yeah, but
listen, the way I always see it is it's not about areas, it's not about the position, it's about the train of thought. And this is what I mean, if you want to do it, no matter whether the amenities are there, whether you could have 50 swimming baths, whether your kid wants to go fucking swimming is a different story. Do you know what I mean? So, like,
yeah, but if you've got no swimming baths, they can't.
But there isn't no option, like, especially where I am, but maybe where you are, yes, but I'm sure you could start. Well, if that's the case, you know what? That's a business venture straight away. But like, at the end of the day, the way I always see it, it's you've got to have the movement there. You've got to want, you in yourself have pushed it, but you can't preach it. So it's up to the kid in itself. You know, like, no, maybe, you know, some kids get punched in the head at the age of 13 and they've never been, like me, like, or anyone else, like, have had a punch before that. Have you ever, you know where I'm coming from? So where, like, you could, you know, if you've only got struck at a certain age and you want to be like, well, you don't want to be evil, but you want to kind of think, well, I want to know how to protect myself in yourself rather than people telling you. You know, you've got to fall over to realise, you know what I mean?
I agree with that. But like I say, you don't know, if you haven't got it, you don't know what you can't want something that ain't there, you know?
Like, it's not if you ain't got it, it's all about learning. Like, everybody can have it, like, you know, in my eyes anyway. I do believe.
I do get where you're coming from, but I also think if you're right, you can't lead a horse. You can lead a horse to water, but you can't make it.
You
drink,
can't make it drink.
There ain't no water there. There's no way of leading it.
No, I understand that, but that's a venture in itself. If there's no water there, then put some there.
Well, that's true, Caps. Anyway, my brother, I'm gonna have to let you go.
All right, I'm gone. I'll see you later.
And I'll speak to you later. You come on the next show.
No problem, bro. I'll see you later.
Nice to speak to you, pal.
Oh, no worries, man.
Talk to you. You take care now.
And you.
Stay lucky, brother.
Lovely. Have a look.
And you. But that was Caps. That was an unexpected phone call. But like you said, like you, very interesting, man.
He's definitely got a bit of love for boxing, hasn't he? Nice tough guy.
God.
He
come on the show before, yeah. Me and Sydney was doing a show and he thought we was funny as fuck. He put on to that, and Yeah.
He's the only person this week that I've met loves his own, that loves the sound of his own voice more than I do.
Oh, God. I'm both on my show.
He gets both on. You never got a word in for about half an hour then, did you?
I went and got a drink. I made a cup of tea.
nice guy though, nice guy. We'll have to maybe we'll plan a show where all three of us are on, and me and him are on. And you're listening.
If he gets in contact, that's all. That's all.
Nice guy.
On Facebook, hang on. No.
So Matty, we had a little bit of a plan about what we're going to talk about. We've had a good chat about boxing. He's apologising. He ain't got nothing to apologise for, Cavs. You're a sound fella, mate. It's nice for people when I'm on this to hear someone else talk more than I do. So I never give Matty 5 seconds to get a word in. So for someone else to do it.
Which is unusual, actually, because I like to talk as well.
So we talked a little bit about, we were talking a little bit about football when I think he joined us, when we were saying about the breaking news that Messi's off from Barcelona. Any news on where he might be going, or did it just say?
There's only going to be a couple of teams. It's either going to be a Chinese team. So who's going to be able to afford him? Would he come to the Premiership? Could he be at Man City?
Would he be any good in the Premiership?
We don't know. Ronaldo was shit up. So.
Yeah, but a different, completely different player. And that's why you can't compare. You can't compare. I don't ever think you've been able to compare Messi with Ronaldo because they're such different players. They're great players in their own right. But listen, you know. Make no mistake about it. Would they work in the same team? I mean, Ronaldo plays. They both kind of play up front. I mean, I know Messi's been playing out more on the right, and I guess Ronaldo more on the left of a strike thing. But like, if you had them both in the team, they both want to be the main man, wouldn't they?
Yeah.
Is
he 32?
Messi's slightly younger, isn't he? I think he's just turned. Is he 30? Well, I'm sure my boy said he was 34. And Ronaldo's like
37.
Let's have a look. Messi. My computer's a bit slow today, so I'll look him up. Good Lord, it is slow. Dear, what's going on there? Born in 87, so 33 in June. Yeah, he's just turned 33, so Ronaldo won't be 37. Yeah, I wouldn't have thought he'd be 35.
He's 37, I think he is.
Is he that much older?
No,
he's not 37. 85, so he's just turned 35 in February. So he's nearly 36.
He's got a couple more years yet, Mr. Ronaldo.
Yeah, but I don't know, because was the rumour Ronaldo would be leaving Juventus before the season was out? I mean, you think I think he's won a title in Portugal, he's won a title in England, he's won titles in Spain.
Yeah,
he's done it in Italy. Is he going to go to France next? I mean, what's that? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Yeah,
5 countries if he goes to Paris Saint Germain and wins.
He's done it. He did exactly with because Beckham's the only one to do it in 5 different countries, isn't he? Because he did it.
Beckham did England, America, France, Italy, Spain.
Yeah.
There's some talk about. Messi going to into Miami.
Wow.
Which would be interesting.
He would wreck the American League. Oh my God, would he wreck that place?
I mean, it's Beckham's team, isn't it? And apparently they're quite good mates, but.
Well, you never know.
Yeah, Man United's being touted. I can't see that, though. certainly wouldn't be going to Bayern.
Wouldn't definitely be going to the Bulls. No place for him there.
No. What about Harry Maguire? He's been withdrawn from the England squad, apparently.
Wasn't he supposed to say to the policeman, "Do you know who I am, silly fucker"?
Well, yeah, but I think there's more to that. There's a lot more to that than we've heard. I think it does sound like he's been a bit of a twat, but I also think that Greek police knew who he was, and one of them is alleged to have told him that your career's over, and booted him in the leg. So, I can imagine now someone who's living is
with his legs. Yeah,
that would be a bit of a.
He just told my phone. They've suspended him from the England squad at the moment, which is something he's going to have to take on chin. I'm sure it's the last thing he's thinking about at the moment. But did he get a 21-month suspended sentence in Greece?
I don't know. I don't know what happened.
Well, I've got a feeling he won't be going on holiday there again. So
no, I don't suppose he will. Yes, 20. So according to reports, Harry Maguire has been handed a 21-month suspended sentence after being convicted of aggravated assault, resisting arrest, and attempted bribery. Excuse me. Someone's tweeted: City are going to get Messi, and we're going to get Maguire with an electronic tag on his ankle. Yeah, so there you go. Who knows? Who knows where it'll end up? But
doesn't the transfer window stay open a little bit longer this time?
Yeah, I can't think when it goes to now. I think it goes to the Friday before the season starts, I think.
Which is
like the 11th of September.
Yeah.
Yeah, I might go to the end of September. I can't remember, but
hopefully, come October, we'll be allowed crowds back in. That'd be nice. It'd be nice.
I can't see it, Matt. I can't see it.
It'd be a shame.
No, I can't see it. I think, I do think. With everything that's going on at the minute. Just can't see him doing it. I mean, why would you? Why would you?
Well, it's just me just wanting to get a bit of normality back, I suppose.
We all do, Matt, but I just think it's too
soon. It's an easy
one to say no to. I've got 10 days in prison.
Oh.
Harry Maguire has been given a suspended sentence of 21 months and 10 days in prison after his trial on the Greek island of Syros.
Well, no wonder he's suspended from the England squad.
That's according to the BBC Sport website. I'm just having a... This is live, people. Live news coming to you. Reports coming in. Yeah, so... Manchester United captain Harry Maguire has been given a suspended sentence of 21 months and 10 days in prison after his Greek trial on the Greek island of Syros. The England defender, 27, was found guilty of repeated bodily harm, attempted bribery, violence against public employees, and insult after arrest on Mykonos. Maguire said after Tuesday's verdict that he had instructed his legal team, with immediate effect, to inform the courts we will be appealing. I remain strong and confident regarding our innocence in this matter. And if anything, myself, family and friends are the victims, he added. The sentence is suspended for 3 years because it's his first offence and the charges were misdemeanours. BBC Sport understands that in the light of the verdict, the Football Association reviewing Maguire's inclusion in the England squad for September's UEFA Nations League matches against Iceland and Denmark, which he's since been withdrawn from. Maguire was arrested along with brother Joe, 28, and Christopher Sharman on Thursday after an altercation with police. Blah, blah, blah. So his brother and his mate have been sentenced to 13 months in prison, suspended for 3 years.
Jesus Christ.
Listen, I mean, if anyone's going to get him off, you think the solicitors at Man United must have to get him out. They'll certainly do it. But
yeah, but that doesn't sound like misdemeanors when you're getting 12, 13 months in prison. That's
yeah, but I think they're particularly hard on stuff like that in Greece because they're holiday islands, aren't they? So yeah. They don't muck around with British holiday makers. You think how we've been over the years, mate, over in places like that. So there's a little bit further down here. The prosecution said Maguire, his brother and friend, then. Hang on, let's start again. Some Greek dude told the court that the events stemmed from Maguire's sister Daisy being injected by a substance by a group of Albanians, and she immediately fainted. Defendants called for transport and asked to be driven to hospital, but instead taken to a police station. Police said Maguire, his brother and friend, then physically and verbally attacked the police officers. A policeman alleged that whilst at the police station, Maguire said, "Do you know who I am? I'm the captain of Man United. I'm very rich. I can give you money. I can pay you. Please let us go." His colleague added that Maguire then said to him, "Please let me go. I'm very rich. I can pay. I'm the leader of Man United." Eventually argued this request may have been lost in translation, suggested Maguire may have been asking to pay a fine to be released. And listen, if his sister's been ejected by some dirty Albanians trying to steal her for a sex trafficking, I'm surprised he hasn't killed someone. Because certainly that would be along the lines of where I'd have gone with it.
Yeah.
So, who knows? But, you know, the truth will out eventually, I guess, but not
he'd come and do an interview. That's what he'd do. Come and do an interview back home. What's that?
Oh, Piers Morgan.
Oh, fucking hell, Piers.
So apparently Messi asked to leave Barcelona by fax today.
Oh, for fuck's sake. That's great.
It's not exactly the most technical. He could have just texted the boss, couldn't he? No one sends faxes anymore. What a load of bollocks.
The fax machine has been working since 2000.
Someone sat in the office at Barcelona going, can anybody hear that? And he's going, beep, 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 beep. Someone got a ZX Spectrum in here. What is that noise? And it's a fucking fax machine being called for the first time since 2002.
Where did Lionel get the fucking number from for this, the tosser?
It's probably the only phone number he's had for the Barcelona for the last few years.
Oh, dear.
So let's have a look at this. There's something interesting here. The Argentinian international 33 sent a fax to the club on Tuesday saying he wishes to exercise a clause in his contract, allowing him to leave for free with immediate effect. Barca were beaten 8-2 by Bayern Munich, and I'd ate for that to happen to me. Hey! Six-time Ballon d'Or winner, made his debut, blah, blah, blah. Barcelona, though, believe the clause has now expired and Messi is contracted to the club until 2021 with a €700 million buyout clause.
I know I was going to pay that for him. I'm sorry.
Well, I mean, let's face it, he'd sell several hundred million pounds worth of shirts all over the world and whatever new team he goes to.
Well,
and if he goes to a Man United or a Liverpool or...
Like I always say, that's the Beckham effect, because that's what people used to buy David for.
He
made his year's wages, didn't he?
Well, I think on the day he arrived, they covered the cost of his first year contract, even at the stupid money they were paying him, which was about £250,000 a week. Yeah. He made the day he got there, they sold enough shirts with his name on that cover his wages for the first year.
So
I may be wrong, but I'm sure that was the right.
No, you're right. But that's the
mad,
best. Fair
imagine
play.
That.
Yeah.
Imagine having that sort of much of a name.
I'd want one T-shirt sold with my name on. See some fucking
podcast. Any time anyone's bought a shirt with my name on is when I bought one.
Yeah, that's it. That's it. Anyway, I need some more boxing gear, Mr. Gary. I've missed out the last time. The last two training camps, I've got no boxing gear off of you.
I've got plenty here, and we're hoping that the legends that are creative team where when this all comes back will be supplying us with a load of new stuff. I'm actually in the process of sourcing some West Barks white collar boxing or some WB boxing and fitness gloves and pads. Now they won't be given away, but they'll be sold at the right price to just cover the cost. But
if you fancy giving away a few vests and a few t-shirts, let me know, please, because.
Yeah, I've got plenty here, mate. I've got plenty here. I can let you have them. The vests are few and far between now in the adult sizes, as I call them. But
yeah, bloody cricket left his vest here by mistake. I thought it was mine. I put it on the other day to go training. I thought I put fucking 10 stone on. What the fuck?
Yeah, that's that'd be interesting. The vests were small when the sizes of the vests that we got were small, so they came out small anyway. But wow, that wearing me or you wearing a medium or a large would have been interesting.
I look like bloody Robin Williams and Birdcage for fuck's sake.
I don't look good in a double XL with those, let alone a large. Yeah, so.
Yeah. Well, anyway, we haven't talked about what we were going to talk about. We're supposed to talk about mental health today, and
another subject that was on the list, wasn't it?
So we'll have a little chat about that for a little while, I think, and then we'll call it a night.
Whatever you need, mate. Listen, I mean, so for me, I found during this lockdown that a lot of people are. Have sort of struggled, but some people have absolutely thrived in it, and I think that's quite strange because I found it quite hard.
I found it hard, but I don't think if we had the lockdown, this podcast wouldn't be started. I can tell you that.
No. Okay, yeah.
And I had to do something to control my mind, and now I've still had bad times.
Yeah,
for sure. And but I'm always going to. What are you doing? You've got a thing.
I was trying to do it really quietly, but you noticed. So, but with mental health, I think things like this, just even if we're just. I mean, even if we just cover the same bloody ground every time that we talk about it, it's really important to get people to understand that it's the thing that should be talked about. It's the thing that we should not be addressing, especially blokes, because we just don't talk about it.
No. I think you have to talk about it all the time. I'm probably going to do a video tonight about mental health. And people might get bored with it or anything, but I don't really give a shit, to be honest.
No, I don't think you should.
It's something that's impacted my life and it's impacted my family. And it came out of nowhere, really. Even though I know, how could I put it? I suffer, but I've learned to live with it. And even though sometimes it's hard, when I say hard, I mean, some days I'm not the same person, Gary. And that is days like that, I just awful. But days like that are the days to make videos and show people what.
Yeah.
Even that, because you just an open book then. And people can see that. It can just hit anyone. Yeah, on some people's sides, on Matt, I'm ready. I'm fucking 6'1", 240 pounds, and whatever. Doesn't give a fuck. Well, Matt does give a fuck, and that's half the problem, to be honest. And but when bad things happen, that's the time to. If you're going to try and promote mental health, that's the time to. Get all the power you can to make a video or not preach, but just say something. And especially if I'm having times where I'm hearing things. See, I've never talked to you about that. And that's scary as fuck, Gary.
Yeah. I'm
hearing things, and I take medication that to stem that a bit, but it doesn't work all the time. And
no, I can only imagine that must be quite frightening to. And I mean, when you hear stuff, do you know it's not there?
No, no. I listen to it, and you can hear things, you get negative things getting said to you in your own mind, and it's not just your mind; it's someone saying it, and that's scary as fuck. Wouldn't you have to talk to your wife about it and things?
No, I get. Do you know what? I 100% understand.
You see, what you're saying,
that inner monologue that.
Yeah.
So you'll think to yourself. So this is how it happens to me. It may well be very different to you, and I apologize if I'm representing it wrong. But for me, I might be sat in my office in the shed doing some work, and I'll think I got to do a spreadsheet for a report. I think, oh yeah, I can do that. And someone will go, this inner monologue, this voice in my head, which is me, it's my voice, just says, no, you can't. You can't do that. And I'll go, well, yeah, I can. And I'll almost have like an argument in my own head.
Yourself. Yeah.
You know, like with the gym, but doing the boxing gym. You know, I've been after this unit I put an offer in on the unit in March, just before the last show, March the 10th or something like that, must have been. It's gone now, we've lost it, so we're not getting it. But I looked at that unit, I wanted that unit, and I worked it all out. I did all the numbers, and I was working the numbers out. And whilst I'm working it all out, I'm thinking, well, financially, I can just about do it. In my head, I'm working the numbers out. My head's going, yeah, but you'll just fuck it up. Like, you fuck everything up. It'll go wrong. You're not capable of doing it. And it's not particularly nasty, but it's like a bully. Yeah. It's like a bully that you had at school. People get at school, and you might not have had a bully at school, but I kind of did, I suppose. But it was just part of life, I guess, 30, 40 years ago, whatever it was. But and the voice is always saying. The voice is always the negative part. You know, when you see the cartoons with the good and bad conscience on the shoulder, that almost constantly going on in my head without the good one there. It's always like,
it's always the bad conscience. One.
The bad one's always there. Yeah. Is that similar for you, or is it a different?
A little. You're on the right track with it. It's always negative stuff. It's always said to me, like, you're fucking useless. Like, well, Carol's sat in here. I don't like really talk about it, but you don't deserve to be alive, and things like that. And when I'm really down in the dumps and not feeling it, not feeling well at all. I wasn't feeling well this morning, but I managed to deal with it. Pick yourself up. I went and got some air, which sort myself out. That way, made yourself feel a bit better. I did what every doctor says you shouldn't do, but I went to the pub and had a fucking beer. But that seemed to chill me out. It just chilled me out. That was it. I had a beer, met Carol, went home.
Yeah.
And, alcohol is not the way forward, I can tell you that. But if it's something in the moment you need, just a drink, just to get out for 5 minutes, by all means, so I can have a fucking beer, but you got to control it.
Yeah, I think a lot of I find a lot of when I get it worse is when it depends on my environment and like if I'm having a it's been a tough week at work so far this week with a lot of things that have gone on. And that's not because I've got a particularly difficult job or anyone's done anything wrong. It's just been busy. I'm sat in a shed. I've got Neil coming up. I've got to self-isolate. I can't really be around the wife and kids, which, they're not particularly upset about. They don't want me farting all over them as usual. But you know what I mean? There's a change in the routine coming up that I know is coming, and I'm a bit not nervous about having Neil. I've had a lot about it. So. But being knocked out for someone to cut a couple of lumps out, it's always going to be
a bit nerve-wracking. So yeah. This week has been worse for it for me. And actually sitting here, and I've not been able to get out and about because of what's going on, because of working. And you know, you can get out in the fresh air, and Jesus, there's enough of it blowing around out there at the minute. But I noticed the triggers. And, I drank quite a lot over the weekend, with it being my birthday weekend, as we talked about earlier. And I think for me, that's something that, you know,
it will normally happen. It will normally happen about a day after you've had a simple, you start to feel bad. Well, I've noticed, I do. If I'm in a, I'd have to be in a darker place to be there anyway, if you know what I mean. Yeah. But if I'm in a real bad place, I ain't drinking anyway. So, I become irrational. I don't listen.
Carol
would
probably say don't listen anyway
when you're going to go. Just say that. But
fucking kind.
Too fucking kind. That's what she said. I am.
Yeah, I think there's, yeah. I mean, having known you as long as I've done, and I have done and known some of the things that you've done for other people, I think, you're probably one that because I don't want to use the word naive, because you're not naive, but it's that sort of thing. You'll help people, even if others are saying, oh, come on, mate, they might take the piss out of you. Do you know what I mean? And then you'll help them, and they'll take the piss, and then, you know,
Then I become their enemy.
and then you're the sort of person that'll bother you as a result, and it shouldn't, because you've done what you can. I think sometimes you've got to not be as helpful to others to be helpful to yourself. You've got to look after number one to a degree.
I totally agree, but I'm not going to change the person I am because of one fuck up and for someone else's actions. So
no, I appreciate that. I
because it's who I am. You know, I'll help anyone. But if I can help someone, I will.
No, I know that, Matt. And to a degree, I'd like to think I'm like that. Yeah. I'm not as like that maybe as you are. But I would help. You know, someone genuinely came to me and said they were really stuck, I would do what I can to help them.
Yeah, but, of course you would.
You know, there's only so much you can do.
Well, it will never happen again, not with Mr. Cricket type thing, where someone come in my house and stuff like that. That will never, ever happen again. Once bitten, twice shy, my friend.
I get that. Listen, you know, those things are sent to try us and try us, they always will. And like I say, you know, when you go through a stressful period of time like that, it's important to recognise that things like that will potentially trigger a darker time or a darker mood or a relapse in how you feel into when you're having troubled times. And I think, you know, if you can spot those things ahead of when they're coming, it does, I find, it tends to make them a little bit easier to deal with, because you understand what the feelings are about, you understand why you're feeling like that, you understand, you at least a little bit of why you are, you understand why you feel like that, and why, you know, and it doesn't necessarily stop the voice telling you you're a piece of shit, you're the worst person in the world, you don't deserve to breathe the same air as everyone else, and all of those horrible things that might get said in your own mind.
I'll tell you what, you tell a doctor you hear voices, that their opinion stays very fucking far.
Yeah, but I think it's a different thing now, isn't it? There's hearing voices, there's schizophrenic hearing voices, hearing a voice telling you to go and kill everyone. There's the voice that I'm talking about, and I think you're talking about, which is that it's almost like that inner monologue telling you you're a piece of shit. But it's almost for me, and again, apologies if it's completely different for you and I've misunderstood, but for me, it's always in my head, it's always my own voice, or a new, if it's not my voice, it's a neutral voice. It's
neutral,
It doesn't sound like anyone else. It doesn't sound like a person I know. It doesn't even, it's not even that I hear it. It's that, and I'm sitting here and I can hear a voice in my head while I'm trying to think, how do I mean this?
I named my voice. I named it Jake. So
nice. Okay.
Serious, dude. It was just easier for me to do that. And I could just go, fuck off, Jake.
Something
like that. And but that's all part of the condition. That's all part of the PTSD and the agoraphobia, there's bits of schizophrenia. It's all part of it, Gary.
Yeah.
And it's, but like I say, I take medication every day. At night, I take my antipsychotics. And when the doctor first told me I was going to be taking antipsychotics, I freaked out. That scared the shit out of me. Because I thought they'd think I'm a psychopath. It's not that at all.
No.
It's there to chill you out. And that you could ask Carol. They don't half chill you out.
Yeah, I can imagine. I mean, I took a very low-level antidepressant for 3 or 6 months years ago when I was having a tough time. I think I'd been made redundant. Generally, life, everybody goes through something like that at some point. Yeah. I was having a tough time. Maybe me and Catherine were having a rough patch. I can't really remember the circumstances around it that clearly.
What was that? Alopram they got you to take?
I couldn't tell you off the top of my head. It was something pran or pram or.
Yeah, it's pram, Talipram.
Mazapram or something like that.
Mirapram. Yeah.
It must have been, it could have been 10 or 15 years ago now for all I remember, but it was a long time. It was a long time ago. And they did initially help. For me though, it wasn't about taking tablets to make me better. It was about taking tablets to help me deal with what was making me feel bad.
Yeah.
It took the symptoms away that the issues were causing. So then deal with the issues. And I felt that the need for the tablets went very quickly. So I stopped taking them. And I'm not suggesting anyone should stop taking anything the doctor's prescribed, because if the doctor's prescribing it, you need it. They don't just give these things out willy-nilly. They might do in some cases, but they certainly don't give out most tablets willy-nilly. They give them out because they're required.
I take the maximum amount of sertraline you're allowed in the morning, about 200 milligrams. I take that in the morning, and I take it. A tablet called Aripiprazole at night, which is 25 milligrams. The maximum you're allowed is 30. And if you get to 30, you've got to have it injected into you. I can choose to have an injection if I like, but I don't want that. The only side effect is you put weight on. That's why I put a bit of poundage on. Nothing to do with my lifestyle, nothing. It's just that is fact, and it just makes it harder to get off, and it's just water weight, that's all it is.
We saw when you trained for the last show you fought on, was that October?
Last October.
Is it October, Mark? No, yeah, you didn't fight in March, did you? Fought in October.
No, I fought in October.
Yeah, so we saw when you trained and you trained hard, that weight just fell off you. I mean, it fell off you. Within a couple of weeks, we saw a difference. By the time you'd done eight or 10 weeks, like you looked like a different person. I mean, I'm just being open and honest and everything. You still had a belly on fight night and you know, I'm in a glass house and I'm throwing stones all over the place. It's just, you know, forgive me, but the difference in you, it all went from your face, it all went from your chest and your arms, and you just looked so much healthier and so much better. And it was really nice to see. And it just goes to prove that, you know, with graft, with real hard work and something to focus on, you can definitely make a difference. And the difference in you as a person as that camp went on, you became... I mean, you've always been quite open and friendly and calm and I know a lot of people that know you're going to think, fucking hell, you don't know it very well then. But yeah, even back when I first met you,
like the first meeting of us was almost like a fight, and it was, and then both of us sort of looked at each other and thought, fuck, we don't want to get involved with this one, and backed down, and we've been friends ever since. And it was like, I've always found you to be a fairly level person. I've never known you to be up and down and all over the place. You've always been, Matt's always been Matt. You know what I mean? I've never known you to change, but to see you chill out even more than I've known you as through the exercise and for the boxing was a really great thing to see. And it was nice. I think you've kept a lot of that as from my conversation. Yeah, I know you have your up days and your down days, but yeah. I think you've kept a lot of that since as well.
Well, I'm definitely more chilled, I can tell you that. Sometimes Carol shouts at me and I just go, just chill, man. Just calm down. Don't worry. Don't worry about it. And I used to go, you don't fucking talk to me like that. But not now. Mr. Chilled Matt,
a few beers, a little bit of a chill out. Yeah. So yeah.
Matt's
having... Sorry.
You hear that? It's like arguing yourself now.
I noticed there's a message on the little chat thing for the podcast. Gary, when am I fighting Kirk?
Oh, that's James. That's James. Fuck you.
Is that Bozarth, is it? No. Oh, slitty eyebrow. Mate, he's got to get to the back of the queue, hasn't he? Yeah, there was a fair old queue for that fight.
Yeah, there's a long, long queue for that fight. Oh my god.
Yeah. I think Carl Jenner's in it. Matt Galgie's in it.
I think Matt, it's got to be Matt. I'm sorry, Mr. Bozart. I think it's got to be Matt Galgie.
Well, Matt Galgie either needs to lose the weight, or Kirk needs to put it on, or a combination of two. Because at the minute,
is he?
Yeah, well, Matt, you know, I'm not going to reveal Matt's weight, but he's a heavyweight, so he's over 91 kilos.
Well, I'll take him.
Kirk fights around 90, 91 kilos. So, you know, there's a few, and you know, we won't put that big a difference in. You know, someone's over 100 kilos, you know, 100 to 110, fighting 120, 130, it's just okay. Heavyweight boxing. It's what you do. But someone who's 90 kilos fighting someone who's whatever weight Matt is that's not going to happen. It's Matt will need to lose some weight, and Kirk will need to put it on, or both, and they'll meet in the middle. And if they can do that, then brilliant. But when Kirk trains,
this is weight off.
Falls off him. Yeah, he's when he trains, he does train hard. At the minute, all he's training is his credit card to pay. To try and recover the economy in through Nando's on its own and TGI Fridays. Yeah.
Eating
out
to
helping out here. Sorry?
Any news when you can do another big show? That's what James wants to know.
We're watching the news as intently as anyone else. We've seen there's a couple of shows in September which are pay-per-view. I can't see how promoters are going to make money on them. They're charging people $8.99 to watch through YouTube or some other app or other. And I really hope they do work. But I can't see how they will. I mean, to be fair, one of the shows is where we went South Morton are involved in it. So because they've got their boxing club. I imagine they'll get their members, their boxing club members, to fight on that show. So the cost of paying the boxers, for example, and they'll have like John Houston. I would imagine will probably know someone that can referee, and they'll have medics involved in the club and stuff like that. So you know, from that point of view, I think they've probably got a lower cost base to start the most, and fair play to them. You know, they've built that club over a long, long time, and it is an outstanding club. So if anyone can pull something like that off and make it pay, or at least cover itself, it'll be them. I think they've got a live streaming platform involved, so I imagine that, you know, I can only imagine that must be, you know, a good way of doing it. So I think from that point of view, I think
theirs will probably be a good success. This, I think it's ICB, the guys I mentioned when we were talking to the other fellow a minute ago. I think they've got a streaming one as well. So, but they're a huge club. They've got hundreds of members. So I imagine, again, getting the boxers and the members that got involved will probably suck up a lot of the cost by not charging and stuff like that. So, but if we were to do it, because we've got the club, but it's not got a home and it's not a big club yet. It's a great club that we've got involved, but we would have to pay for paramedics. We would have to pay for the ref, the ring, the light and sound and everything else. So it would be a lot harder and a lot more expensive. The venue's going to cost us a fortune. So you look at the South Morton as an example. They've got a venue. So they've got the gym. They've got the ring. They'll have a ref in the club. They'll have the medics in the club. They'll have, they've got light and sound in there. So they've got everything they need to have a show in their gym that they can stream. They don't need the space for the crowd. So it doesn't matter about the size of the building. It's all about that ring and that makes it nice and easy for them to put that on. And do you know what? Genuinely wish them all their success.
Calling in. Hang on. Hello, my boy. Fuck you. You all right?
Evening all.
How you doing?
You slitty eyebrow freak.
How you doing, boys?
We're fine.
It's the eyebrow slit team. Here we are.
Oh, he loved it. He loved it.
Team eyebrow slit. How you doing, brother? All right?
Not bad, mate. Yourself?
Yeah, not bad, not bad. I've managed to self-isolate for just over 90 minutes in my shed tonight with Matt. So it's been a good one. But
I see you've
been doing a bit of training with Ricky.
Yeah, mate. I've been training with Rick for most of lockdown, to be fair. Just trying to work on my defence and stuff. So my next fight, I'll be ready for it.
Nice, good work. He's a good lad. He's a good lad, Rick.
Because I didn't
know his shit.
How much difference, like sparring compared to fighting, it's a massive difference, isn't it?
Of course it is, yeah.
Mate, I didn't realise that, so I found out. Well,
it doesn't matter how many times you tell someone who's not boxed on a show before what the difference is. I mean, we warned everyone, as we always do, look, you're going to step in that ring, you're going to go in there with the best intentions of boxing, and then the other kid's going to punch you in the face.
Exactly.
And then everything you learn is going to go out the window.
Man, what a night that was.
But, mate, you did yourself proud, didn't you? So,
honestly, I was so glad I fucking got hold of you and done it. It was one of the best things I've ever done.
You think that's over 5 months ago now?
Mate, it's flying by, isn't it?
Yeah, well, we would basically be halfway through. Well, we'd probably be just about starting the next camp now, usually.
Yeah. Yeah, we'd have the meeting in the old document house.
Yeah, usually have it. I think it was about a week ago. It came up on my memories. We usually do it sort of mid August, and then start the training sort of late August, beginning of September, depending on when the show is. And this one we were planning November for this one, but as I was saying to Matty a minute ago, there's no way anyone could genuinely plan a sports hall show.
Yeah,
at the minute, with any sort of levels.
On Instagram, like the SAS boys, they're doing like a pay-per-view event, aren't they, sort of thing?
Yeah, I think they're doing it from the gym they use, which, you know, again, if you've got that sort of facility, that's brilliant. But the only boxing gym around our area is the amateur gym. And, we've approached them twice now. And they're not. And you know what? I don't have any malice about it.
Is it because it's
white
collar boxing?
I imagine so. Yeah, we didn't really get we haven't been given a reason. I mean, it was a long time ago the last time I contacted them. So maybe their stance after lockdown and after all this nonsense is over will soften. I hear that there's a lot of development going on in that area of Newbury, isn't there, down Faraday Road. So I know they were looking at units I was looking at. So I don't know whether they were planning to move or not. But I think
I think, you know, if we could, it would benefit both to share a unit potentially. But we've also been talking to Shaolin Tigers, who we rented off.
That gym was quality, like it was really small, but it was like a proper gym, wasn't it? Decent.
Yeah, it was somewhere for us to call home. But as I was talking to Scott this week, who owned the building it was in, and like the reason we wanted our own place was because we were getting to a point where we kind of outgrown renting gym space. We needed to be able to take have the slots that we wanted, because we were doing it at sort of 7:30. I mean, we had it all day Monday. We had it for a couple of hours, or an hour on a Thursday and an hour on a Friday. Yeah. But we could have put sessions on. When you look at when we were at Hermitage Village Hall, we had Monday for 2.5 hours down there. We had Tuesday and Thursday. The place was packed out. I could have got the sparring sessions we had going again on a Friday. If we had our own space, and then when we had the show training in the beginning of this year, we were training on Wednesday as well. So we were pretty much 5 days a week with people saying, "Oh, are you ever going to put a Saturday morning on?" And it was like, well, I've got to have a bit of time myself at some point.
Yeah, like you don't have time for yourself because you're so busy sorting train out and stuff. I bet it's mayhem.
It is, but I mean, I love it. Don't get me wrong, I absolutely love it. But the difficulty was, like, some of the training sessions were because of the times we got at the gym, I wouldn't get home until sort of 10 o'clock because we'd start at sort of 8. By the time we finished at 9 and I packed everything up and talked to people and left, I'd be home at sort of 10 o'clock. And it was hanging around, that hanging around period before training started was like a dead period. I couldn't really do anything. But if we had our own place and we could go 6:30 till sort of 7:15 and 7:30 till 8:30, I'd be away by 9. I'd be home 9 o'clock every night of the week. I could put it on every night of the week and still have a bit of an evening for a couple of hours when I got back. Yeah. So it was much more manageable to do that. But so, you know, talking to Scott, we're still keen to try and work something out, but it's, you know, getting somewhere that we can...
Thames Valley ABC, like, would they want to get involved or not?
Well, that's who we're talking about with the amateur club. You know, it'd be nice but like I say, the couple of times we've contacted them and spoke to people who sort of know them and that, we've always been sort of discouraged from either discouraged from approaching them again or been told, no, the club's for our members and no one else, don't hire it out private.
Yeah, that's true. But then, like, put it this way, like, some of the lads I've seen training at the show, there were some quality boxers there. So you had, like, Jordan Howes, Tony Glover, not me. Like, the lads look inspiring.
Yeah, well, I mean, we wouldn't want to use it the nights that they use it, because you don't mix white collar with amateur, yeah, because amateur are carded and carded for a reason. We don't want to tread on toes, and we're not trying to steal boxes off the amateur club if they want to box out. I mean, in fact, we had Chris go the other way, didn't we? So yeah. he won the belt a couple of shows ago.
I've seen yesterday, Chris.
Yeah, and he's boxed for Thames Valley in the couple of weeks before our show, and won his first amateur bout. Performed really, really well. And we've had guys that have been training with the amateur club come down and do our fitness sessions because they wanted to do a little bit extra. And we were having a session on a night that the club wasn't open, so they came and trained with us for their fitness, because obviously all our fitness sessions are boxing fitness based. So, we probably supported the club without, not that we wouldn't exactly support them, but without meaning to. Yeah, without meaning to, without doing it deliberately, we've supported them anyway. And I'm sure we've had guys go and use their gym on their sessions, you know, that aren't carded amateurs, but are down there to do some fitness and a bit of sparring. I mean, I know Mikey O'Neill went down there with Lee Jones and
Reading.
Say again?
I was meant to fight Mikey in that show in Reading in May, but obviously where COVID's cancelled it, so
yeah.
Cancelled, but I meant to fight Mikey.
Have you heard any more about that show? I'd be interested, because I'd be interested to see when that come back out. I was looking forward to it.
No, mate, so I've texted the guy that runs it and he hasn't got back to me, but I've got a few of my mates that are fighting on the same night and they haven't heard nothing from anybody.
Mm.
So I can't really.
Whose show was it? Was that Rob Clark?
Yeah, Rob Clark from
Workdown.
Yeah, love Rob. Lovely bloke. Absolute diamond geezer, that bloke is.
I was going to fight for him on a veteran show.
You were going to fight him at one point, weren't you?
I was fighting. What is his frigging name? He's on my Freddy Facebook. And he's an ex-Bloody Para. I was going to fight him.
I thought you were going to fight Rob at one point, though, weren't you?
I wasn't Rob. I was actually going to fight. Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
And then he done his back, didn't he? He's had a back pop or something, hasn't he?
Yeah.
Because I was looking forward to see Mark Banfield versus Tank. That's what I was looking forward to see.
I think Tank would have hit that. You know,
guys, that's got to be your comeback fight, surely, mate.
You've got to mate, I'm 46 years old. People keep asking me about fighting Rich, and like neither of us. The problem is, it's no one wants to see two overweight 40-plus-year-olds sort of wailing on each other and then leaning on each other because we're both fucking knackered. Like Rich, by his own admission, doesn't train. I've not been training for 2 years properly. I'm 46 now, just turned 46. And I was thinking about it the other day. I love boxing. I love being involved in boxing. I love training other people. But I haven't got – my body just can't cope with the level of stress that you put it under when you box. And the reason I'm having this up now is because when I trained so hard for my last fight in July 2 years ago, I just wrecked the knee again. And that led to the operation I had that November, which led to this operation. And it's just been a sort of a downward spiral. And after this, the only thing they can do is a knee replacement. So you think, well, how much do I want to push that?
Yeah, so, you've got to look after yourself, haven't you?
I did start doing a bit of running in lockdown.
What
the fuck? Yeah, same as that.
So I'm playing the recorder.
what are you doing, Matt, mate?
He does this. It's the podcast. It's not me. He does this earlier. Fucking.
When we get, it's a boring morning. It's when I. It's because I'm talking about my knee. Everyone's getting bored, so I'm trying to override it. Get fucking entertaining, you bunch of morons. So
but yeah, so I was doing some running as well during lockdown, just to keep my mind going, because I was getting so fed up being at home. I was just going for runs to try and keep my mind active.
But yeah.
After a while, my joints and my knees were hurting. I couldn't do it anymore. It was just too hard.
But I think
depends where you run as well.
But you do it. When you train, you do it. Go on, mate. Sorry.
But when I train, I do a hell of a lot of running. I do. I remember one training camp. I refused to spar because I heard just, I heard a UFC fighter say you didn't spar no more.
That reminds me of that Damage Babbage fella that fought on the Eddie Hearn show at the weekend. Yeah. He said he doesn't train, he just spars. That's all he does. He just spars all the time. And he said, what better thing to do for training for boxing than box? And you can't fault that logic until you get... Well, he said, I'll take anyone. He said, I'll fight anyone. I don't give a shit. He said, there's a fellow over in his country who's been calling him out. He said, I'll fight him. And I think you'll see him start fighting the likes of probably like a David Price or someone like that if he's going to box again. That sort of level of boxer that's been around the sort of skirting around the sort of the challenges, but not actually good enough to fight for a title. Probably fight for a title, and he'll probably keep walking through.
British level fighter, isn't he? Like he's like British level,
every time he
fight a Povetkin or something like that, he's been stopped. So
mate, good he can't stop against Povetkin. Fucking hell, Povetkin's walked through.
What about Dillian White on Saturday night? What a punch!
But I was watching. Oh fuck! Okay, I've got a bit of ice stuck around the filling that up. But there was someone. I was reading something on. I can't remember if it's Facebook or Twitter, and it was like, you watch all these coaches now going to be teaching everyone the jab, slip, and uppercut. But you shouldn't be learning that unless you're an elite. That's an elite level boxing
move. That's a basic move.
Fuck off! It's a basic thing that we teach everyone. Jab, slip, uppercut. You throw the jab out, make sure you're in range. You slip the counter jab and you just fucking throw it. Well, we teach it as a body shot, really, but Because as that jab comes over the top, if you slip that, the body's open, so you just whack the body shot in.
Some of the best boxers and fighters in the world, what do they do? The basics very, very well. That's
good foundations.
And that's what they do. They don't all do Mike Tyson uppercuts and that. The basics very well, and that's what Klitschko used to do. He never do anything flashy, just do the basics.
I was watching that fight, so I watched the highlights, and from the start, Povetkin was like throwing a jab and he threw a left hook. So I think White was expecting a left hook. So when he slipped, that's when he come up and like he sort of surprised him with the uppercut. And mate, when it hit him, he was just out one even before he hit the floor.
Out cold, like,
brutal, man.
But White, I thought White was boxing really, really well. He was boxing different to everyone. I mean, we talked about this a little bit earlier, but like I thought he was boxing really well. He was obviously wary of that big overhand right, but he was landing his shots, he was doing his work and getting off. And that's not like him. Normally he stays in the pocket and he gets in and he just goes to fucking war, doesn't he? Yeah, he just wants to trade. But he didn't want to do it. And you could see he didn't want to do that. And he was right not to do it, as it transpired.
Dangerous, mate.
As he found out the hard way. I think you're right. I think he was double wary. So the jab came out and he went to, I'm trying to think which way he went, but he sort of tried to.
He was right, didn't he?
Yeah, he tried to. I think he tried to slip outside, tried to avoid the overhand right, and that uppercut just
fucking nasty, man.
Okay, now just come out of nowhere, didn't it? I mean, it was a long. We had a long way to go.
Fucking Mrs. J was fast asleep, and as soon as it landed, I went, "Oh fucking hell!" Woke up.
Yeah, I woke up. Catherine thought I'd seen a big spider. She said, "What's that? What's the matter?" Because I went, "Fucking hell!" Everyone's in bed. What? You seen a spider?
What's going on?
That Carol's Saturday night all the time with bloody when I'm watching UFC at 3 in the
morning. Yeah, but we did it at 11 o'clock at night. You do it about 4 o'clock in the fucking morning.
I know. Well, speaking to Mr. Pettifer as well.
Yeah.
How is Big Dad? Are you
alright? He's fine. Just come back off holiday.
Fair play to him.
Hang on, I've got to let someone into the war room.
Yeah. That's
all. Ben's coming. Are you busy?
Ben's coming for his pot.
I'm all right, my brother. I'm not too bad. I had a bit of a shitty morning, but I'm all right.
Yeah, good.
And now you've been on it, you can come on it properly now, can't you?
Yeah, boy, decent. Have a little chat, the lads, and that's nice.
Yeah, well, you could tell you what. What about next week? You come on it.
Yeah, and I can call out Kirk properly then, can't I?
You can have a little yap proper then.
Like we said, my brother, that is a very long and illustrious queue that's been forming for a number of years.
Do you know what? Like, the reason I signed up to the West Barks White Collar Boxers is because I was on Facebook and I saw Kurt giving some bloke a load of grief, saying he's the best fucking man, newbie sort of thing. and then I was like, right, I got to training, I met him. Do you know what? He's one of the nicest blokes I've ever met. He's sound as a pound, Kurt.
He is.
He comes across as an arsehole, but he's our arsehole. That's the difference.
He fishes. And if he's
pantomime.
And at training, Matt, I've also said one thing. Like, he's always encouraging the lads. He's always helping people. He's brilliant at training. Trains hard.
He's like a pantomime villain for me. Does he believe everything that comes out of his mouth? I think to a degree he does. I think he knows that. I mean, I don't know if you were there, boys, but when we had Brian Doyle come down, and Kirk had been giving him shit on the internet, and now Bruno's a lovely bloke, but I've done some rounds of Bruno.
I've heard stories about our big Bruno. Apparently, he's a fucking absolute animal.
Yeah,
mate. I've done a number of rounds of him, and I always come out with a headache. He's got a head like a bowling ball, and fist like a steam train, mate. It hurts me more to hear his head than it does me hitting his head for him. And he came down, and Kirk had been giving him shit all day. And fair play, after we did the training session, and Bruno come over from Farringdon, he got all the way over, rushed over from work. He did the training session, and he always gives his all. I said, "You staying for a few rounds, Bruno?" Yeah, mate. I said, "Right, jump in then." So he got his gloves on, got in the ring. So who's going in? And the first person through those ropes was Kirk. So I might as well get it out of the way now, boys.
Exactly. And the other time, big guys, when Big Pav turned up the training, Kirk was calling him a pussy in the group chat.
Yeah.
The first person to get in the sparring, Kirk.
Yeah. Absolutely. So,
yeah,
like,
you know what I mean? Yeah, Big Pav, don't say to him, you fucking, is that all you got, you big fucking Russian? Because they don't.
No,
poor fucking.
He said to him, you're a big
pussy. It doesn't go too well, guys.
Who was, Matthew, answer me this question. Who was it that said, go on, try and knock me out?
Me.
Yes. And what happened, Matthew?
He shook my little legs down to the fucking ground.
I have never seen you rock. It was like seeing a boat in the middle of the storm and in the middle of the Atlantic. Your legs were shaking left and right after hitting two or three punches.
For me, he goes, Matt, you're a very good boxer, but you don't move your fucking head. That's
Matt,
all he said.
Don't worry, mate. I had the same thing down at Swindon. Bobby Collard absolutely fucking took my head off.
Yeah.
Oh, cool, fucking. I remember that. And that wasn't a power shot either, was it? That was just beautifully timed. Beautifully timed.
It's just another level. And in that little ring, there's nowhere to go. You can't escape the fucking big fucker.
No.
That's always better than yourself.
We've had some good boys down there over the years, and it's always been a privilege, and we will get going again one eventually. You know, I'm confident of it.
And we've
had, I've had setback after setback trying to get a gym together, and one thing or another. Hopefully, I think I'm just trying to get the money together to buy a ring. I've been offered a ring that's a really good price, and obviously I can't pick it up this week, but. But yeah, I'm definitely just trying to get the last couple of £100 together for it. It's nice and cheap, and you know,
they're one of them portable rings, guys.
Yeah. So the idea is that until we got home, I can get it into, for example, get it into Moorside and put it up in 15 minutes, get it down in 15 minutes, get it out the door so we can actually have sparring sessions and such. You know, it'll only ever be live sparring.
You need mats on the floor with it?
Yeah. That's any other thing I'd have to buy. But at least then I've got a small ring for when we do get somewhere and I can chuck it straight in there and I ain't got to worry about that side.
No.
It's done then. I've got loads of bags. I've got I've got weights and kettlebells. And I need to get more of that sort of stuff, but I ain't got a place to store it at home, so... I can wait till I actually get a gym up and running, but it'll come.
Slowly.
Yeah, I've had a couple of wobbles over the weekend, and I think that's part of what's made me taking it back to sort of the mental health side of things. I think that's what I've struggled with, is seeing this dream that I was getting close to building fall away.
It's a massive thing, and it's exciting as well, Gary. It's exciting for our club, well, your club.
It's our club, and it's always been our club. Anyone that comes on is part of it.
You're the boss. That's what I mean. Yeah. But
we'll have to come up with some decent names for the gym, because I'm not going to call it the WB Boxing and Fitness Gym.
No.
That'll be like the company that runs it, I suppose. But
Window Liquor Gym.
No, I'm not going to call it Window Liquor Gym. What do you reckon, Eyebrow Boy?
He's gone. He's disappeared.
Oh,
yeah.
No, he fell off.
He fell off the radar.
I thought he'd gone quiet. You can't normally shut him up that quick.
I don't know. You would have to have a sit down and think about it. One more round. Call it something like that.
I've got loads of little ideas for names, but
Final Bell, something like that.
I don't know. We'll come up with something.
Right, anyway, we've done 2 hours, Gary.
We have, mate, we have. So, be a miracle if anyone else is listening, but...
There's 3 people listening.
I think 2 of them are us.
Me and you, and someone else. So, but that's all good. That's all good.
Mate, it's been a pleasure as always, my friend.
Yeah, all right, my brother. I'm going to leave you to it.
Yeah.
I'll speak to you soon. All right, you take good care of yourself, Gary.
And you, pal. Speak soon. Much love.
Bye-bye.
Peace out.